Jimmy on a beat, boy. Okay.
Boomerang. Whatever you say.
Boomerang.
Okay.
Boomerang.
Yeah, boomerang.
Whatever you say.
Boomerang.
Okay.
Boomerang.
Yeah, boomerang.
Whatever you say.
Buongiorno, my friends. This evening, I will be talking about an anime called BNA, which stands for Brand New Animal, which is the full name of the series. However, some websites are just listing it as BNA. And this originally aired on Fuji TV and also became available on Netflix Japan, where you can currently watch it in case you live in Japan or you happen to have a VPN. And it will also become available worldwide on Netflix later down this year, I would probably assume somewhere down the summer. And BNA was created by Studio Trigger, and this is very respected studio, obviously. A lot of people consider it as one of the best studios out there, at least on the artistic groups. People really praise Trigger alongside with Ghibli. And I watched a couple of Trigger titles. I mean, none of them, like, actually fully through. I maybe seen, like, 10 episodes of Little Witch Academia, and maybe, like, 5 episodes of Kill la Kill, and maybe I did watch also a pilot of Gridman. And I think they have definitely their own artistic style, and they do a lot of original stories, which are not really based on, you know, existing manga or, you know, light novel, and that's how, like, they basically make money, and that's why they have that Patreon account. So basically they can do merchandise where they don't have to pay commission to anybody else because it's their original work. So, you know, it's good for them because they get all the money and revenue, and they don't have to share the sales of the Blu-rays or anything like that with other companies because they own the IPs, which is really smart. But historically, when we have looked into a lot of anime which are originals, haven't really been that strong story-wise. And yes, there has been a couple of really good ones visually, but it doesn't mean that, you know, just because something's visually good, it doesn't mean that the overall package is actually great. And obviously, it's really nice to have studios like these, which are kind of like doing their own stuff. And I think a lot of the Trigger's content also is a lot more Western-friendly. At least BNA definitely doesn't have those cliche anime things you normally see, so it makes a lot of sense why Netflix decided to pick this one out outside from other, like, airing anime. And so let's kind of like explain a bit of the premise. So it's definitely not Beastars. This is a quite different setting because in Beastars there's no humans, obviously. In BNA, you have world where humanoid animals, which are known as Beastkin, exist, and they pretty much have consolidated into the city, which is sort of a safe haven for them, which is called the Anima City. And our, you know, main character, Michiru, basically suddenly turns into a tanuki, which is, well, is raccoon in English, obviously. And, well, she's running away from her home because she's hunted by humans because, you know, you're pretty much killed on sight. And she will become a refugee in the city and tries to, like, figure out why exactly she turned into a beastman and, you know, wants to kind of, like, reverse, well, not the spell, but, you know, the gene that she has inherited that had made her to be like that instead of a human. And, you know, it's a story that really kind of, you know, tackles a lot of social issues. So there is some type of social commentary made in this. Not really that heavy. I mean, Japan really hasn't been, even with their political shows, been that extremely heavy with politics. It's just kind of like broader topics or subjects usually that get touched upon. And yeah, we could talk about, is this racism? But it really kind of goes into interspecies relations, which is a bit different. But we have seen in the West a lot of, you know, True Blood is a good example where it's about vampires and vampire rights along with humans. And there's interesting stuff like that that you can do, which is not necessarily related to race. Some people will obviously draw the parallels. This is a, you know, beastmen are black people. And then, you know, and then other humans are like a representation of whites or something like that. Something crazy like that. But it's not like that. I think it's definitely a story about you know, coexistence between humans and beastkin, while at the same time, kind of like, there's a lot of genetic stuff in the series, which kind of like goes into why the Beastmen go into rampage sometimes, and they're like high, you know, testosterone levels, so to speak, and it kind of like goes into that type of a stuff. So there is definitely social commentary, but there's a lot of like science and gene stuff, which obviously I'm a big fan of. Everything about genes I get really excited about, and obviously I'm a big fan of like anamorphic stuff, so Beastars and everything that has basically talking animals is pretty great in my opinion. And the story, you know, basically, the as Michiru comes into the city, she will meet this wolf known as Shirou, which is some type of detective or some type of a right hand to the mayor. And there's a bit of like political games going on. The humans are like funding terrorists, which are doing attacks on the city, targeting Beastmen outside of the city and also inside the city mostly. And there are these like socio-economical things also a bit portrayed. Not so much about like some certain Beastmen like living in high class life of, you know, richness, and other ones are poverty. Poverty is one subject that kind of gets touched upon, but it's not definitely a big theme of this series because it's not really portrayed in a very grandiose thing. It's not like showing that there are these hyper-rich Beastmen out there, just showing kind of like these slums a bit, you know. It's like maybe, so there's not a contrasting of income gaps. So yeah, I mean, it's a series about, well, you know, socio-economical commentary, and that's what it's really about. There's a lot of fighting as well, and, you know, about moralities, obviously gets touched upon, and should you hate humans, and should there be peace, should there be infighting between the Beastmen? These type of questions get kind of, like, explored, and also about, you know, Michiru will go. Some level of character development I was not very impressed by. And by that, I mean, like, did she actually go, like, this super big revelation towards the end? Sort of, but not really, in my opinion. Because, well, I can't really spoil it for you, but we can talk about it in the comments. The story really, you know, when I look at it as a whole, I think it was okay. The thing is, this was definitely a story that should have been told in a movie format. Sometimes you watch movies or TV shows and you think, oh, this would have actually worked better in the other model. And this was a story that, I'm not saying it was feeling filler or anything like that, but I definitely thought that it could have been told in a 2-hour movie, definitely, or 1 hour 50. It could have been condensed into that type of thing. It could have removed a couple of filler characters there and there and just have everything packed up in a movie. And I think that it was kind of not really that making a lot of sense to do a 12-episode series out of it. I don't think the story was really that interesting. And I don't think that they did really that amazing job of making characters to, you know, drawn into or falling to. I just thought that, you know, with a lot of these original animes, I think the story is always lackluster. It doesn't at least shit the bed and go completely reversal towards the end. And there could be even a sequel. To be honest, I would not want to really see that. Or, I mean, I maybe would watch it because I guess some of the artistic appeal is still okay in the series, but like, I mainly always watch shows for the story value, and I really didn't see a story that was completely new or fresh, or I didn't really feel characters were really that special to me that I would kind of get drawn into them. So I think there was levels where Trigger really didn't really manage to deliver here. It's a still okay, solid series. And I kind of like it because it has that sort of a Western appeal and it doesn't use all of these dumbass Japanese gimmicks that some anime use. And yeah, I mean, I guess the artistic stuff was still good. I like the designs of the characters. The music, pretty lackluster, nothing to really mention about there. The ED was better than the opening, but I didn't love that either too much, and rest of the soundtrack really didn't impress me out either. So but I'm a bit overcritical here. It's a very standard anime, knowing it was Trigger, and this is a series, I mean, they have done great series in the past. Little Witch Academia was great, to the point I've seen it at least. And I thought that this was definitely not their best work, and they could have done better. But, you know, I thought it was still okay, and I enjoyed watching it, but you could have been better, definitely. And also, before I wrap up, I think it starts out very, very slowly. On the first and the second episode, I was really close for dropping the series because I didn't even feel it was really, like, pumping the story up or kicking, you know, the quality up, as some people anime start to pick up slowly a lot more. And Brand New Animal has a very, very slow start, I would argue. And maybe I would have loved to see kind of like the beginning done in a different way, where she turns from a human into Tanuki. But yeah, that's pretty much my thoughts about it. I don't really have anything else to add. If you're a Trigger fan, it's probably a must-watch still. Thanks for watching. I'll see you guys next time.